With figures showing hundreds, in some cases thousands, leaving the church yearly, the rapid rates of exodus force us to contemplate what the future of churches will look like. There is, of course, no easy answer to this, but liturgical leaders seem to agree on two things. There is the biblical explanation.
Will the church die? No. No, the church will not die. God said to Peter, you know, Jesus said to Peter, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the end will not prevail against it. So the church, as church universal, is not going to die, because it has been given that wonderful guarantee by Jesus.
And it is that guarantee that church leaders take as gospel, that their churches will be around long after they leave this earth.
The church as we see it, in its fracture, in its challenge, in the lukewarmness of people, in the disinterest of many of its own adherents, that's how we see the church. But that's not its truest essence. The church in its truest essence, it is the body of Christ. Not figuratively, it is the body of Christ. It is Christ's body. Christ's body will not disappear from this earth.
But some churches will. Some will not be able to withstand the test of time and technology and will disappear into the annals of history.
I think perhaps we have not adjusted as quickly and as efficiently as we could have.
Reverend Annabel Lala Ramkelawan agrees with modernizing church life. She herself has seen the Presbyterian Church break down walls of its own.
You know, steel man in church was a no-no when I was a young person, you know. Singing choruses was, oh man, they would disband us. We were just being, you know, persons who wanted to create an upheaval in the church. Now, slowly, it has been accepted.
What this moment in time calls for, Bishop Berkeley feels, is a total rethink of the way Christianity is practiced in the 21st century. And while church life may look vastly different in the future from anything we've grown up knowing and going to, its existence could depend on change.
Some congregations will probably die. Other new ones will spring up. We have to be ready to make the adjustments, to be fleet of feet and mind, to respond to the changing dynamics of population, of new trends, new developments in technology and otherwise, new ideas coming on into the world.
But while Bishop Berkeley says churches must change with the times it lives in, Archbishop Gordon insists there must be a return to fundamental teachings of Christianity, which is the foundation of the faith.
Will a local church survive? Not necessarily. Because if the local church doesn't do what it's supposed to do in discipling people and helping people to grow in their commitment to Christ and to really become disciples and missionary disciples, reaching out and bringing that good news to other people. If they're not doing that, local churches will die.
That's a common concern among many church leaders and is why Reverend Lala Ramkelawan is urging churches to re-examine the way it teaches its catechists, who in turn spreads the doctrines of the church.
Re-educate your people to your doctrines. What do we believe as Presbyterians, Roman Catholics, and Anglicans? What is our belief as a people?
For the Reverend, who has served as moderator of the Presbyterian Synod, Christianity in this country may have descended from the lines of Europe, but now it can incorporate a Caribbean flavor.
We need to revisit the way in which we worship. And you know, as moderator, I had the privilege of traveling to almost all the continents. I haven't been to Australia and India. And particularly Africa, they have redesigned their worship within their context. But as people in Trinidad, we have not ventured into redesigning worship for our context, and we have to contextualize our liturgy for where we are.
This kind of thinking is met with optimism for the likes of Dennis McNichols, but he doesn't think churches are in any danger of becoming extinct.
I think church is going to exist, but I think it's going to change a lot. Because I think everybody wants something to believe in. Everybody wants to believe that while we're here, this life that we live, the struggles that we go through, it's for something, it's not for no reason. And I think as long as church provides that hope, it will exist.
The common denominator, though, is that churches must return to serving its people. At his Hebrew church, Johnny Ramone says he is understanding more and more what society should look like, as opposed to what it is.
The Most High, we call him the Most High, designed everything to work as a family unit. Right? That's why you say, like, we have a covenant with him. So it's like our marriage. So everything in the system of existence is supposed to work like our marriage, the integration. So the core thing for the church is family.
For Ramon, his focus isn't on those falling away from churches, but rather the ones that are still there.
How do we forgive?
So it doesn't matter if you have six people in your church or 6,000. If you have six and you are effective in terms of dealing with them as a family, then it doesn't matter. Those six could draw 6,000.
Essentially, that's how Christianity spread, from one man to 12 men to now millions around the world. Ramon feels it is time to revisit the principles the church was built on.
So if you go back to what the mission of the church was, what the design of the church was, then young people will not only stay, but will draw others, because that's what the scripture said. Not by our symbols, not by the things we do, not by the scriptures we speak, but the love you have for one another. That's how people will know you are mine.
From the lay people to those who stand on the pulpit, they all agree the church has lost touch with those who make up the fabric of it. The ones that Jesus Christ himself alluded to in Mark, the church is a hospital for sinners.
People don't only want to see us preach Jesus, but they want to see us live Jesus. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you visited me. So other ministries in the church has to be developed.
Mainstream churches are now all in the same predicament, battling against common outside forces. Reverend Don Hamilton put it diplomatically blunt. They can all work together towards shaping the future landscape of local Christianity, or risk becoming irrelevant in an ever-changing society in the 21st century.
There's no way that one denomination or group could do it alone. There's absolutely a need for now breaking down some of the barriers and networking if we're going to continue to have a strong influence in shaping the culture and future of Trinidad and Tobago.
The greatest hurdle hampering this process will perhaps be differing doctrines. The teachings of all these mainstream churches date back centuries, some like the Catholic Church, thousands of years.
There are some essentials of the faith and there are some non-essentials. And conversation and dialogue needs to start happening on the essentials. Now, some we have made the minor, major, and it creates walls. And the walls have to come down. So the future of the church, for me, must be tied to the networking of the bodies, having serious dialogue.
By just his word, you can tell the Reverend represents a vastly different group of churchgoers, mainly because his message connects with more youth voices, like Dennis McNichols.
Maybe it's time we move away from the checklist of what makes you a Christian and start thinking about what makes you a good person. And maybe that will help people to feel more involved and feel more welcomed in the community.
Even for Reverend Don Hamilton, who oversees one of the most popular and fast-growing churches in the Caribbean, interfaith conversations are key to not only the success of neighboring congregations, but also the survival of each church.
Outside of that, the future of church would look like it would become a dinosaur, irrelevant, because you're not speaking to me and you're not speaking to my language.
It is now up to this group of people. Different religions they may lead, different opinions they may have. Their doctrines may not teach the same things. Their values may not necessarily align with each other. But for the common cause of Christianity in TNT, They must all wrap their heads around a solution for the survival of one of the oldest religions in the country. Their denominations of Christianity may not concur, but perhaps their monotheistic belief will be the beginning of several churches working towards one common cause for one common problem.